Hello and welcome to Politics Today. I'm Farooq Pitafi. Once again, we are going to talk about Maulana Fazlur Rahman's momentum. And later in the program, we will try to focus on the Prime Minister's visit to Karachi as well. Especially regarding Maulana Fazlur Rahman's Azadi March, it is important to note that Maulana hasn't changed the dates. The government's offer of dialogue stands nowhere right now. And interestingly, today he was in Islamabad. Maulana Fazlur Rahman spoke with journalists, particularly journalists who are actually reporting for the international media. One of such reporters who were there is with us. We are going to talk about all these matters and more in order to understand what exactly is Maulana's platform, what he intends to do, and why is he being ambiguous about various things. In order to help us understand these issues, we are joined by Javed Rana, a senior journalist. He was there. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. And next to him is Shafiq Ahmed Saab, another senior journalist, especially has been covering the religious political parties as well. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Next to him is Waqas Saleem, an anthropologist, political analyst. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program as well. Javed Rana Saab, tell us what you heard today.
I think to begin with, probably Maulana Saab was trying to send a message to the international media that it's not the religious card that he's trying to use.
Okay.
They, according to him, there are political issues, economic issues, because of which he's going to launch this so-called march, which we call as a Azadi March. So I think at the heart of entire press conference was, there was a couple of questions where journalists insisted, what do you want to do? Is it going to be a one-day protest, or it's going to be sit-in, prolonging for weeks and months? What he said was that it's not going to be as long as it was by the PTI government back in 2014.
Not PTI government, PTI
PTI as it was then opposition party. But it is going to be a bit different. In what manner it is going to be different, he did not explain. He said, let the ambiguity prevail.
Why?
That was the question, why. I think my understanding of the situation, I also spoke one of another leader of JUI. My understanding is that they want that the government should overreact. By, you know, erecting these shipping containers on the roads. He said that actually the government itself would block the entire country.
Okay.
And that is going to...
Entire country or Islamabad?
It's going to be from major parts of Pakistan, because it's not going to be only Islamabad.
And like Pind Dadarhan?
From northwest and southwest, I think there are going to be some sort of situation when you are going to stop these marchers, obviously, there is going to kind of situation where the police might have to block those roads. So I think it appears that Maulana Saab is following a strategy whereby he's going to rely more on supposedly the mistakes, the administrative blunders or mistakes, you may call them, than of having his own strategy. So
yeah,
what is this?
When I come back to you, I want to ask you what exactly are his demands. But let me first go to Shafiq Ahmed Saab. So your take so far, Maulana doesn't seem to be able to be dissuaded from actually coming to Islamabad and marching on Islamabad. What exactly is happening right now?
Look, I mean, the government is fully prepared. They have done preparation, and I think so the government likely to stop them from the march, especially the sit-in protests in Islamabad. And I think they will use what they can use legally under the ambit of law. And they have their own strategy.
Okay.
And I think that what Javed Rana Saab said about the ambiguity of Maulana Saab, and
Maulana Saab.
The reason is that a few days back, Mian Nawaz Sharif wrote a letter to Fazlur Rahman Saab, and it was a clear indication that they are supporting you for the march, not sit-in protests or derailing democracy. They are not with you.
Have we seen the content of the letter?
I got from my sources, and today it was confirmed by Parvez Rashid, the former information minister, that yes, letter has been written by Nawaz Sharif.
No, letter has been written, but as to
the
what
content
was
is
written.
Concerned, I mean, this is what one of the senior PMLN leader was saying,
okay.
That it is indication that they are not with Maulana Sahab on the issue of sit-in protests or dharna.
Okay.
They are going to support you for the rally or the march.
Okay.
And the ambiguity is that both
and,
the opposition.
And how do you explain that? Why would PMLN not want?
The reason is simple. Let's say if suppose if Maulana Sahab succeed, mm-hmm. So where the two opposition parties will stand, by the way,
okay.
The two major opposition party, Maulana Sahab has only the strength of two MNA in the National Assembly,
okay.
While the other opposition combined more than 100
seats. Define success in Maulana's terms. What do you think will happen? So then you'll say Maulana has succeeded.
This is what they are thinking. Let's say it is the power show of Maulana Fadlur Rahman.
Okay.
So if, let's say, for example, like I know that the government has fully prepared the plan and they will not allow them to have a sit-in dharna, even there may be some arrests before the march, what I expect. But for example, if Maulana stage a rally or sit in for several days, mm-hmm. So where the two major opposition parties will stand? I mean, their power will be weaker then.
Okay. But when you say success, that means if he successfully comes and sits here.
Success, yes. I mean, this is what Maulana wants, that he
okay.
wants to march, but he is not disclosing to have a sit-in protest in Islamabad.
Mm-hmm.
But if, for example, like if, supposedly if he does, so where the two opposition parties, like that is why, and the other thing is that Pakistan People's Party has announced their own protest rally.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, is there is some uncertainty
right.
Within the opposition parties. They are not sure what Maulana Sahab wants to do and whether they will take part in the dharna or not. But opposition is clear that they will only take part in the march, not
right.
in dharna.
Right. Waqas Saleem, your opening statement about Maulana's plans.
Thank you, Patafi, for inviting me. I would, in fact, start with this notion that ultimately, whosoever gains from this dharna, Pakistan will be at the losing end. Starting from 1958, when the first dharna or sit-in was planned in Pakistan against the democratic government,
mm-hmm.
and then now moving on to General Zia's regime, and then moving on to the dharna of 1993, and then moving, then there
dharna
is a...
Dharna of 1993?
I mean, the dharna was planned by Ghazi Hussainam and other parties,
okay.
and then moving on to...
You're talking about Salman Rushdie incident, right?
Exactly, that was against People's Party's government,
oh,
I guess,
okay.
if I'm recalling it rightly.
Yeah.
And then moving on to the marches which were brought by Allama Tahirul Qadri, and now you can see the way Imran Khan, you know, came to have a sit in mm-hmm. Islamabad, and now it's Maulana Fazlur Rahman.
Mm-hmm.
So it was political instability that came to Pakistan. It was uncertainty. It was a slower economic growth that came to Pakistan as a result of these politics of agitation
now,
and the way they have been brought
I
in.
I admire what you're saying, but the point is, I can see this, you can see this. Why is it that political class cannot?
Because all the political forces and the political players have their own objectives, they have their own agendas, and the way they have been, you know, trying to make it to the power circles. I mean, it's an open secret now. So in this connection and in this age, the way things have been, you know, managed in our country, this is quite unfortunate that our economy is growing at the rate of 2.4%,
mm-hmm.
and we have to, you know, think about China-Pakistan economic corridor. We have, you know, poverty in place, and then at this point in time, this politics of agitation. I mean, you are not letting any democratic government to basically have a strong foothold and move on a policy that will steer Pakistan out of this crisis. After every 2-3 years, there is a sort of agitation that comes to Islamabad, and all the country, all the media, all the limelight focuses on that politics.
Yeah.
So I would rather, you know, say that it's Pakistan that is on the losing end. It's not
okay.
the political forces. It's not the players who are in the game.
No, I get that. And I'm really happy that our thinking class is thinking about these matters in this way. But my concern is that while we keep on criticizing such incidents, I haven't seen any solutions being offered. For example, let us go to the grassroots. Islamabad is a finite space, especially red zone is a very finite place, right? somebody comes, takes over, sits there for quite some time, and we don't even have a clue how to actually handle it. I'm not talking about the future, I'm not talking about today, but the past instances show you that anybody who is a protester can come and sit there like this. Why?
Unfortunately, we have remained part of the problem. We haven't remained part of the solution as a nation. So that is why whenever you ask someone...
As a nation. Come on.
They will give you, they'll criticize, but they will not
give you
the solution.
We might contribute to the problem of the nation, not solution.
That's what I'm
saying. But nation hasn't been part of the problem.
I mean, it seems that this is something that exists at a broader level, that we are generally becoming part of the problem. We are not becoming part of the solution. For the last few eras, we have seen that there is a solution to this dharna agitation, that let the people sit.
Right.
Let them sit.
Now, Javed Rana Sahab, I see a dichotomy here. I mean, on one side, Maulana actually takes the pains of calling you all over, and you are representing foreign media, and he takes pain of explaining that he is actually behaving like a political party, not a religious party. And yet, whenever you listen to his speeches, whenever you listen to his supporters, they are talking about Ahmadi issue. They're talking about Asia Bibi issue. So where do you see that dichotomy? And is the international media actually going to report that bit as well?
I think those questions were raised with Maulana Saab. And the underlying point that he was making, that these are his apprehensions. And part of the demand he's making, that the Islamic provisions and Islamic laws would be protected. One wonders if there is any threat to these laws and these provisions. Apparently, there is nothing of the sort that exists. This is essentially based on his apprehensions.
Okay.
And another point that he was making, and part of which does make sense, and that is that there was a parliamentary committee which was formed by the Speaker, National Assembly.
Okay.
And even the terms of reference were not made till now. So there is
which committee?
To probe into the rigging allegations of the previous election. I think there he makes a lot of sense, but at the same time...
No, after 1 year? I mean, you could have picked any moment.
Again, I said the part of the... Partly he's right, but at the same time, when he was asked why he has not availed the legal avenues, there he said that it is in like 1977, there is a kind of situation where there was a massive rigging. So so it was a decision by the opposition parties. Probably he's referring himself that let's not avail the legal avenues because there is a massive rigging. My understanding is that there was a massive rigging in 2013's elections, which he then said was there.
Okay, we used to have this argument during 5 years as well.
The point I was making, he said there was rigging then.
Okay.
In 2013. But after a couple of weeks, he became part of the government.
Right.
Then he did not raise those objections.
No, this is what I'm saying, Rana Sahab, in Pakistan's history, at least as long as I remember, one party wins in Pakistan, the rest of the parties always complain about rigging. Right? Nobody loses in the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, and that is a tragedy. But let me ask Shafiq Ahmad Sahab, particularly about this carte blanche that seems to be given to Maulana by the liberal class. Maulana goes to SAFMA, and there, and other such bodies, and there he is actually talking about everything, and nobody actually stands up and confronts him. That, look, you're talking to a liberal forum and you're using liberal terms, and yet your main motivation is protesting Asia Bibi and freedom of an Ahmadi.
I think, despite addressing the liberal forums, actually he's a Maulana, and his party name is Jamiat Ulama Islam, so it's a religious right-wing party.
Right.
And because people are asking the questions that what is the purpose of your agitation?
Can I stop you here for a second? I'm told Zain Qureshi, MNA Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf, has joined us on telephone. Let me ask him how exactly is the government preparing to take care of Maulana's march slash his dharna. Zain Qureshi, thank you very much. Sir, what exactly is on cards right now?
Assalamu alaikum, sir. Thank you for bringing me on your show. As far as the dharna is concerned, and from what I understand of it, I think they've taken a decision to do the march. Whether they have taken a decision to do the sit-in or not is yet to be taken. And I think any contingency the government has to make has to be made once all the tables are laid on the all the cards are laid on the table. If you ask me for my personal opinion, I can give you that. And that is that this so-called dharna has no legitimacy, because this dharna is being conducted to serve a personal interest rather than a national interest. And I don't see it gaining too much momentum.
Yeah, Zain Qureshi Sahab, I'm glad that you're talking about the legitimacy as well. But let us talk about the surprise factor that might be there. Maulana is pretty ambiguous when it comes to his plans. So the government is going to take his word for it, or the government is going to prepare that no surprise is sprung on it?
Sir, I feel the government has to be prepared for all eventualities. Far as the Maulana is concerned, you have seen how he is preparing, how he's getting his people to prepare, how they've formed a uniform force, how they're giving them sticks in their hands. As far as I know, I mean, people draw a comparison to PTI and Dharna PTI did, but I think a very clear distinction has to be made. When the PTI leadership decided to do the Azadi March, one of the things we focused on was the fact that it was a peaceful protest. And you will remember for 126 days, the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf workers sat in Islamabad, and it was a peaceful protest. There was no uniforms being made. There was no militia being created. So I think that's a very unfair comparison to draw that people are drawing.
But Qureshi Sahab, when Maulana says that his protest is going to be peaceful as well, you're not ready to buy that. Is it true?
Sir, if he's saying it's going to be peaceful, but on television screens we see people in the thousands wearing wearing a uniform and carrying sticks and being craned, actions speak louder than words.
Okay. Right. Zain Qureshi Sahab, thank you very much for your time. Let us come back to the studio. Shafiq Ahmed Sahab, resume.
Yes, I mean...
Liberal Forum.
Maulana Sahab, look, the first name he had given to the march and protest was Namus-e-Risalat.
Okay.
Okay. So it was...
Then the Prime Minister goes to the UNGA and makes that fabulous speech.
Amazing speech. So then he changed the name. Because, you know, first of all, Hurmat-e-Risalat, by the way, the honor of prophethood. Right. I mean, honoring prophet, like... Who am I, by the way? If I want to honor the Prophet, I should follow the Sunnah instead of marching on the road. So there was no point at all. So then he changed the name to Azadi March. So Azadi March, and still he keeping all the card to his chest, not showing it openly, like not he is in negotiation with other main opposition parties. But the two main opposition parties, the PMLN and the Pakistan People's Party, they have apprehension, by the way, because the Pakistan People's Party is a left-wing liberal party, I mean progressive party, and even...
If you say so.
I think it's a progressive party, of course. So I mean, it will be difficult how to convince their own people. Like, we are following a religious leader like Jamiat Ulama Islam leader, who has to MNA in the National Assembly, and he is going to steal the entire show. So, I mean, this is how... The situation is, that is why...
When you're talking about People's Party, there's a skit going on YouTube elsewhere where Maulana is asking for 50,000 people, and then Bilawal says, okay, we will give you 50. And Maulana says, only 50, and he says, look, we are already over-promising, we only have support of 10. So that becomes a problem as well. I don't know whether that is true or not, right? If you're looking at People's Party, it has limitations when it comes to Islamabad or when it comes to Punjab.
Of course, I mean, Pakistan People's Party lost the election in Punjab and in Islamabad as well. So, I mean, the Dharna, the JUIF is going to start from Karachi. So they will give in a little bit free hand by the provincial government. They have their own plan. That is why he announced to launch the protest from Karachi. And but I think that it is difficult for both the opposition parties to assemble that much, I mean, the public or their supporters.
You're talking about People's Party
People's
or PMLN?
Party and PMLN, both, difficult. I mean, for People's Party, it is also difficult to add some people in the rally of Jamiat Ulama Islam, because Jamiat Ulama Islam is a right-wing political, religio-political party.
Right.
And that was for the progressive and liberal party workers, it will be quite difficult for me.
Yeah, but People's Party is not no stranger to Maulana. Remember Maulana Qasim Niazi and so many others.
I know, but you know, we shouldn't forget, like, it was like rivalry, like in the past. I mean,
they always had alliances.
They had alliances. They remain alliance. Yes, this is
right.
True.
Perhaps People's Party is not in that great a shape to actually agitate right now.
Their main leadership are behind the bars, by the way. This may be one of the reasons.
Bilawal is the leader.
He is
free.
Yeah, he is free. The only leader. He is free. The remaining others, they are in behind the bars.
Okay. You're talking about the father and his sister.
Father, sister, Khurshid Shah. Why not? He's the opposition leader.
Right. Waqar Saab, PMLN. Do you think PMLN doesn't have that kind of punching power right now? It is because of the schizophrenia within the heart of the party, this brother divide that might be undermining the party.
If you look at the dynamics of PMLN, ultimately the word of Mia Nawaz Sharif prevails.
Okay, which is now Maryam Nawaz's word.
Probably, and then Mia Nawaz Sharif is directly, in fact, interacting with the party and the supporters as well.
A party which he trusts so much. When he sends a letter to Maulana, he has to find an independent emissary also who should take a copy of that letter independently to Maulana.
You know, when it comes to power politics and when it comes to these sort of media gimmicks, they have a different, kind of appeal to the masses. And Mia Nawaz,
gimmicks?
I mean, sending a letter separately and then sending an emissary.
Is it not clear he doesn't trust his own brother?
No. I guess if you look at the
and history, he has a good reason why he doesn't trust his brother.
I guess this is
when he was prime minister, his own brother was constantly undermining him.
But the point is that ultimately, when it comes to the PMLN politics, the word of Mia Nawaz Sharif prevails. There may be dissenting voices within the party, but ultimately, when the party takes a decision, and that decision is, followed by either half-heartedly or wholeheartedly by the second-tier, third-tier leadership. And then when it comes to PMLN...
And what about the first-year leadership?
First-year leadership...
Remember that day when Nawaz Sharif and his daughter came back to the country about to actually surrender themselves to law? Their own, Nawaz Sharif's own brother, couldn't make it to the airport.
Yes.
I mean, they kept on roaming about.
But the point is, it's not necessarily that he was deliberately not making it to the airport. It was the government who was also, withholding them and not allowing them to, get, because Lahore is a strong base and there is a support that also exists. And I guess we should not raise so much eyebrows to the political processes which are going on in the country. When it comes to PML,
what are you talking about?
With regards to PMLN, I'm talking about, and if you look
which
at
political processes,
the processes which are going on at the moment, I mean, let the processes go the way they are going.
Okay.
But at the moment, since we're talking about Maulana Fazlur Rahman and the way PMLN is siding with Maulana Fazlur Rahman,
is it? This is the question.
They are because
one moment it seems that Shahbaz Sharif is going to be coerced into cooperating with Maulana. He is the only one who is free and outside, right?
Why we are forgetting that Shabashi has a backache, severe backache.
Okay.
So he has many
the
problems.
The party also has a backache.
I mean, the health problem, health issues, by the way.
The party also has a health
problem. Maybe a little bit.
Okay, right.
So, Patafi, I was talking about that PMLN, in PMLN, the word of Nawaz Sharif prevails and it stands. I mean, if it's not about that Mia Nawaz Sharif or Shahbaz Sharif, if you start leading a political party and if I start leading the same political party, definitely I'll have my own team and you'll have your own. So in that context, both the brothers have their own teams. There is no doubt about that. But ultimately, when it comes to the political strategies, they have remained together and they will remain together. Now, when it comes to the march of Maulana Fazlur Rahman, PMLN, the kind of support base they have, because they have a support base in Rawalpindi. They have a
GT Road actually.
GT Road and then Rawalpindi. They can bring in people to Islamabad for the sit-in. But the problem is that
since you mentioned Lahore, Lahoris don't go for sit-ins per se.
That's why
I have never seen them going for sit-ins. They agitate and they come back home.
If you let me complete, then probably I'll make the same point because interjections at times.
Okay, you object to them.
Exactly. Okay, right. So, if you look at the support base of PMLN, it's very difficult, keep them glued to the sit-in. They'll come, they'll protest, and they'll go. Okay. The same was case with the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf, that their supporters used to come and go. It was very difficult for the PTI to, keep them glued or 24 hours to the same scenario and to the same scene. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to the religious parties, be it Tahrir al-Qadri or be it Maulana Fazlur Rahman, they do not come with their voters. They come with those people whom they have kept in a state of false consciousness. And these people, obey them damning gods.
Don't do that. Don't actually claim that people are brainwashed or they are
because they are they have been they are
disciples.
They are their disciples. They are not their voters. Probably JUI is not coming up with the voters. They are coming up with the followers who are in the madrasa and who are basically followers or the followers of
Qadri supporters. Hmm? While I had a lot of objections to whatever he was saying, I realized that most of his supporters were very well educated.
They were well educated,
civilized kind of.
They were well educated, but you have to remember one thing, that Tahrir al-Qadri is a practicing peer, and most of the people were the followers of Tahrir al-Qadri.
These nuances
and the
are
people
important.
Were from the Minhaj al-Quran Tehreek as well.
Right.
So and political parties do not hold such type of followers. So that is there is a difference. So there is a difference, between when it comes to Maulana's people who are coming for dharna and the political party's support base.
Political parties don't have that kind of supporters, sir?
Our foreign minister has huge supporters. He's also peer.
No, that is true. But I'm talking about the opposition parties, and I'm asking you, do political parties have that kind of committed support? Because Bhutto aaj bhi zinda hai, right? Bhutto is still alive. And there are people who would say similar things about Nawaz Sharif and his party.
I think there is a three major political parties, two to three political parties. They have their supporters. PTA supporters have their own mindset and behavior patterns during these past protests. And then we have PMLN, and there is a third category of the religious lot. I think they are more loyal.
You are writing of People's Party altogether.
People's Party, you see, this sit-in politics is very different. We have to make distinction from a day-long protest, because you can gather maximum number of people
about a party whose leader used to volunteer a train bharo and then jail bharo movements. And they used to actually agitate
again, but not the way there are new unfortunate precedents which have started in this country.
Nothing is new in Pakistan.
And then these kind of sit-ins prolonging for months, and we don't know what is going to happen now.
Vakas actually made this point earlier.
But the point
that
is,
since 1950s, we have seen similar kind of protests.
Basically, we are now analyzing the support base of these political parties.
Yeah.
The kind of the supporters they that they have, I think among all these political parties, the loyalty of supporters of the religious parties is far more strong.
Why?
For very obvious reason. It is a factor of the religion.
Okay.
Because these people actually project religion as the main reason because of which they are being brought out on the roads, mm-hmm. despite denial from Maulana Saab. I think. The fact of the matter is that it is a religious card that he has used when it comes to his base, the main support base, which are these madrasas. Now, he's been claiming that there have been millions march. I don't think there was any million march.
Right.
By maximum, there could have been tens of thousands of people on the roads that he might have brought in the past. Mm-hmm. And now he's claiming that, the government can block half million people, but the 1 million will even nonetheless would come on the roads, which appears to be a huge exaggeration. Right. My understanding of the situation is that as a matter of the likely scenario.
Since you are one of major sources that are there, that were there today, I have to ask you another aspect. Remember People's Party when Maulana was an ally and PML, and also when he was also an ally, the economic situation, especially at the start, was similar to this one, right? When you are trying to remake economy, when you are trying to actually implement your own principles, why did Maulana not protest back then? Did anybody ask this question?
In 2013, again, Pakistan went to the IMF. There was a similar situation, and there were a lot of allegations against the People's Party. Right. Similarly, that we have seen now of PTI blaming PMLN for the economic mess. There were a lot of similarities.
Yeah.
And there was also the similarity of the rigging allegations,
right,
as Maulana Saab is now pointing out. But I think the situation, there are two factors. One factor is that there seems to be a kind of a personalized, a sort of personality clash between Prime Minister Imran Khan and Maulana Saab. The language that both use against each other, particularly, I would say, Prime Minister sometimes use inappropriate language against Maulana Saab. I think that is also part of it. But
wounded ego.
Bigger part is that the Maulana Saab, the fact of the matter is, after decades, he's out of power. And then he felt threatened that this time around he got just few seats.
Okay.
And he says that he was deprived of his seats because of rigging. I don't want to go into those details, how far.
Okay.
But the bigger picture is the bigger picture is that Maulana Saab is maintaining an ambiguity, and I don't see that they are going to be sort of dharna in Islamabad.
Okay.
Probably these
in Rawalpindi.
No, I.
Peshawar.
There is.
Quetta.
I think. Karachi. They are going to be blocked by the security forces.
No, but I understand what the state might do or the government might do. But what does Maulana actually plan to do? Why is it unclear?
In order to create a...
Is he actually planning something?
He's
just actually creating the strategy as we go along.
I think part of his planning is that to create a situation where everybody thinks that something big is going to happen.
Right. Can we call it Maulana's improv class, where he's improvising right now?
Look, let me give you a very interesting point beside your question, I'm sorry. On 31st October, beside this dharna, there is a very important event of Tablighi Jamaat.
Yeah.
The main Tablighi congregation will start in Lahore, Rawalpindi.
Okay.
And I got some information from my area, in Charsada and the surrounding area.
Mm-hmm.
And they say that some of the leaders and workers of JUIF are convincing the people, those who are associated or attached with Tablighi Jamaat, that instead of going to Rawalpindi, they should join us. This is equally important.
Actually, it will happen the other way around, by the way. Tablighi Jamaat has bigger gravity.
Of course.
So it attracts more people.
And my fear is that majority of the people will join Tablighi Jamaat at Rawalpindi instead of joining JUIF.
Okay.
So it may be a negative for the JUIF.
Is it a possibility that Maulana comes to Islamabad and says, okay, I'm taking the party to Rawalpindi and we are going to be part of the congregation? Huh?
I don't know. But you know, all the followers...
Is he trying to improvise or he has a plan?
I mean, he has a plan. I mean, he is not in a mood to negotiate with the government, despite announcing some team to talk to the government. And the government actually taken a decision very late by appointing Parvez Khatak Saab to
negotiate. Parvez Khatak Saab's decision was late. But earlier, they actually tasked the religious minister to actually go and talk to Maulana.
Yes, but Maulana is adamant that he will go for the march.
Yeah, but... Here's the problem. We don't know what he's going to do on 31st.
Yes, ambiguity.
We don't know what exactly are his demands. And then he's flashing those videos where actually the supporters are in uniform and they are carrying batons. And then he is getting the, salutes and all that.
Yes. That's really amazing. Yes. And, you know, they have prepared a lot of slogans, a lot of songs for the rally, by the way. I've seen...
Songs?
Songs. I mean, religious songs, by the way.
Okay.
I'm not with the music and guitar.
Because if you remember PTI, their Azadi March had a lot of soft power. They had, you know, a DJ and people who were there, right?
The Maulana has their own DJ with religious people.
Maulana himself is a DJ in that context.
They have their own rhythms.
Different rhythm, by the way, without music. So they are...
No, but we are confusing two parties. Jamaat-e-Islami has that kind of culture, where they have taranas and they play taranas. Maulana actually, it is all Maulana, nothing else.
No, I mean, I cannot, honestly speaking, Jamaat-e-Islami is a different kind of party as compared to JUIF. Unfortunately, I mean, JUI lost many seats in this election. It was very poor performance by Jamaat-e-Islami. But they have the same kind of tarana, so they are fully prepared for the
GUI
march.
JUI also has that kind of taranas, okay.
Oh, yes, of course. It's a lot. By the way, I've seen a lot.
Anthems
In Pashto language. So, because a lot of people, they will come from the Pashtun belt of KPK and Balochistan. Okay. So, mostly they are in Pashto language.
Okay.
And I think, but on the other hand, I think that the government has its own strategy. And
what exactly is that? You have to tell us about the strategy.
I broke this story on this platform 5 days ago about the letter, the second letter of Nawaz Sharif to Maulana Fazlur Rahman.
That's a strategy?
No. Okay. No, let me disclose you that government will try not to allow them even for the march. There will be arrest.
Where?
A large number.
Where?
Everywhere.
From the source or here in Islam?
No. From the source, by the way.
Okay.
In Karachi.
But is it not frustrating, Shafiq Saab, that...
But he says that I'm going to be arrested and there is going to be alternative leadership. He says I even made a plan.
Yeah, like he is going to trust another person with leadership of his party.
Cases.
I mean, sir, with due respect, is it not frustrating that you and I are sitting in Islamabad and we have seen this these political or religious groups repeatedly coming over and staging sit-in. And then, whenever there is an attempt to stop them, it is containers which essentially block you and I, not the protesters. They make it to the D-chalk in any case, right? All the parties. Now, is it not frustrating that we don't see any alternative, any solution, where law enforcement has some plan that nobody is going to go and capture D-chalk?
Look, first of all, there's a national action plan, and one of the clause suggests that there cannot be a private militia with a uniform or brandishing batons instead. So a lot of people, that's what is my hunch or my belief, that they are going to be arrested under the national action plan, which was agreed upon by all the political parties. So action will be taken by the government, and they will not allow for the march and for the dharna.
But again, talking about Islamabad's
blockades.
Administration.
Yes, they will definitely have these shipping containers on the main road, which will be really frustrating, not only for the for those who are staging march, but for the ordinary public. But let's see. I mean, this is. I think that they will place shipping container on the main roads leading to the deep chalk, maybe. Worst point is Faizabad. Really, which is really disturbing.
Vakas Saab, here's the question. I'm going to benefit from your being an anthropologist, a sociologist, right? Don't I have a social contract with the state of Pakistan? And you also?
Yeah.
That we will be protected?
No doubt.
So if somebody comes over and sits here and bullies us, what should the government do?
Container is a strategy to protect us, actually.
To protect us
or the government
or protect the protesters from us because we can't reach there, they do.
Actually, unfortunately, if you look at the way statecraft is in countries like Pakistan, where the situation ripens to protest after every 1 or 2 years, but in fact, if you look at the mature democracies like you have seen in the other parts of the world. For instance, if you look at the Hong Kong, the way protests are going on and the way they are, protesting, and this life is standstill, and is in fact not standstill, halted for quite a number of weeks. Mm-hmm. So in the contemporary scenario, when there is an agitating party who comes to either Islamabad or any part of the country. So there is unrest, and then state can protect people, and state in fact protects people by placing containers and just, you know, not allow the...
You realize the owners of those containers, those containers are not empty, by the way. I hope
they're,
you know.
They're not empty, but...
So there is another social, another aspect of the very same social contract that seems to be compromised when you actually ship or bring those containers here, and that material that is inside is blocked, and it is open to some kind of vandalism as well.
No, the it's generally the mud that is inside the containers. No. What I have seen, because
last time in 2014 there was a big story that they brought in the customs and other stuff, right? And they brought the containers and things perished inside it.
That might be the story, because I have no idea about that story. But as far as I know, I have seen mud-filled containers around my house as well. And the road is blocked, but...
Shafiq sir.
No, I don't think so. You are right, because they forced the truckers to place the shipping container on the road, and this is by force. And they told them that they will pay the money. But last time, the government did not pay the money even to the truckers. Yeah. They were asking for the money.
That's a concern. Listen, I have to actually, I'm being told that we have to conclude the program, and I will. Repeatedly, we keep on mulling over these matters. The problem is there seems to be some kind of imagination deficit when it comes not to the state, but you and I, us. We don't seem to have answers for as to what to do. And we are not recommending that to the government, not the previous government, not the government previous to that. I have been arguing that there should be at least water cannons. Nobody seems to even have water cannons in Islamabad, right? On that worrying note, I have to actually conclude the program. Javed Rana Saab, thank you very much for being part of the program. Shafiq Ahmed Saab, Bakar Saleem, thank you very much. Always great having you on the show. Because you have listened to our participants, we still have to wait and see when we get clarity on the matter of Maulana's agitation. Till that time, we'll continue to talk about these matters. This was today's program. Thank you very much for watching us. Take care.